How's it going, YouTube? We are kicking off a brand new week tonight. It's good to be back. We had a little bit of a sound check yesterday, so if there are any minor imperfections, we will deal with them after the show. So, hello, how are you? Welcome back. The Butch is back for tonight. Yes, Butch Witkowski, Strange Days, happens the final Monday of every month. Let's give a shout out to everybody who is here so far tonight. We say hello to Hector for being in the gold medal position. Academie Silver, the gorgeous and talented Steph Dickey in third. Hey, John Cardi, wreaking havoc. Good to have you here, man. I'm still getting compliments about the interview that we did, man. You know what? I'll get you in touch with Butch, too. Because he'll be interested in your case. Rodrigo, good to see you. Hi, Showtime. Thanks for coming on in. Ronald Payton, everyone. Ronald Payton is here. Persevere, good to see you. Thurston Howell III, thanks for coming on in. Hello, gorgeous Nicole Mellett. Welcome to the show. Yes, she is, everyone. The stunning and talented Kira. She's right there. She'll be selling autographs after the show, line up to the left. She charges $10 per autograph. No eye contact, please. Peace World, good to see you, my friend. Bonjour, Jean-Paul. Comment ça va? Mary Bone, everyone. She's a vegetarian, Mary Bone. Good to see you. These guys, thanks for coming on in. Fancy Summer, good to have you back. And here's the scroll on here. There's Dirty Filth, everyone. Dirty Filth will be signing autographs on the right. Your choice, autograph 8x10s, color or black and white. So make sure you grab that. Aggravating, good to see you. Alan Moccasin, thanks for coming on in. Hey, Big Fat Creep, welcome back. Paul John Tavares, still no Stanley Cup for you, but you're working on it. Dose 66, boom. How are you, my friend? Bigfoot Rob, good to see you. Hungry Burrito, thanks for coming on in. Cloudy with a Chance of UFOs, good to have you back. Steam Train Mark, happy Australia Day. How is tomorrow looking? Please let us know if we are alive in the future. We appreciate that. And so we scroll on down. Chris Jarvis, good to see you. The gorgeous, lovely, and talented Heather McIntyre, everyone. Let's give her a round of applause. Hey, Boss Monster, how are you doing? How was your flight today? Rafaela, welcome to our chat room. Thank you for joining us. Hi, Howard. Good to see you. Project Blue Book, nice to have you back. Chris Reed, thanks for coming on in. Awesome. Amy Svensson is here, everyone. Make sure you say hello to her. Who else we know? Richard Elmore is here, everyone. Give him a wave, he deserves it. I'm seeing him in the stomach. Okay, where is... Well, Kevin, good to have you back, lady. TH, thanks for coming on in. And TH, Butch says, I wait all month for this show with Butch. I don't know why. He's cranky tonight, people. He's got extra crank. He's flavored with cranky sauce. Middle Child, good to have you back. Thank you for joining us. Beaston, always a pleasure to have you here, my friend. Thank you. Bombshell Bomber, how are you? Thanks for coming on in. Chris Moe, good to see you. Meg, thanks for joining us from Sweden, my friend. And can you please tell Elias Pettersson to score some goals? We'd appreciate that here in Tocqueville. And you got that Swedish touch with him. That's what we're going to talk from now. The Swedish touch from his wife. There you go. Faster, good to have you here. Eugene Braxton, my brother, how are you, my friend? Good to have you back. Fast Dogs, nice to see you. Let's see here. Who else we have? Focus. Good to have you back. Chuck Ben, how's your beehive? Let us know. And appreciate that. And Matefoot, thank you for joining us. Gorgeous Larry, thanks for coming on in. Prairie Fire, you're still a good shot. Who else do we got here? We have. There she is, everyone, from KPML. Angelina is back. Thank you for joining us. Dean McKenna, good to see you back. Cat Chaser, how are you, awesome Cat Chaser? Thank you so much for the amazing super chat. You are such a great supporter of this show. Thank you for everything that you do. And let's see here. Steve Stockton, everyone. Steve Stockton from KPML. He's out in right there. Good to have you back, Stevie. Hi, Sandra. Good to have you back. Hey, we're caught up. Butch Witkowski, everyone. The Butch is back. Yes, we're glad to have him here. He's healthy, he's happy. You know, I know my sound is probably off a little bit from my voice. We are working on that. And we're trying to get figured out for tomorrow. And if we have 28 seconds until we are running home, Lori, thank you so much for that amazing super chat. I really appreciate that. Thank you. Super chat's a great way to support this show. Don't forget to hit the thumbs up, thumbs down, thumbs sideways, and do a little flop on facebook.com/thesorvault. Hit the subscribe button on our channel here as well. Here we go, everyone, in 5 seconds. Let's rock and roll. Ooh. Of Central British Columbia to you listening around the world. This, my friends, is Spaced Out Radio. I am your host, Steve Scott, sitting in the captain's chair of SOR headquarters. We welcome you to tonight's show and our cluster affiliates around North America, usually on Talk Stream Live, Revolution Radio, and KPNL. If you want to take a listen to our archives, they are free for you by going to youtube.com/spacedoutradio. Just do us the favor. Hit that subscribe button. Follow us on Twitter at Spaced Out Radio and on Instagram at Spaced Out Radio Show. Our website is spacedoutradio.com, where we have a plethora of features for you, including rock notes, bubble force, and reading up on history trips that's on the news wire. Today's show is brought to you by Child Charities. Help make the world 10% happier by visiting Child Charities today. You can find them on our website. The final week of every month, Butch Witkowski joins us for Strange Days, where we take a serious look at the cryptid and paranormal realm. Butch is the creator and lead investigator for Pennsylvania's UFOtalk.com. Butch is a former police officer who's been searching for answers to the unknown for almost 30 years. His craziness will tell you that he's not even close to the answers yet, but he and his UFO Talk team will continue the case for monsters lurking all around us. Then at the bottom of hour number 3, I will bring you the SOR News Line, brought to you by Paranormal Magazine. Butch Witkowski, always a pleasure to have you back and your first appearance here in 2021. How are you, my friend?
It is a little bit weird,
man. I'm just curious how everybody's doing out there and how you're doing. How's your New Year's start?
Pretty good so far. A lot of interesting things going on with a lot of good reports coming in for a change.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
What's coming in?
UFO sightings, because we've had some really cold weather but clear skies. So, that just goes to show that people are out there looking. And, went out to the old chicken farm to see if those energies are still there. And they're gone. I guess they went home.
Where are the ghosts?
Yeah, right.
Well, Butch, for everybody out there who may not be familiar with you, what got you into this field?
Well, it started in 1989, actually, when we were in Tucson, Arizona. Had some fellows out there building some cactus, well, cactus on the property. And we really laughed, and really laughed. And the wife of me got some ice cream for the property, so we all out on the driveway, drinking ice cream, taking a break, and I looked over and everybody started looking up and I started looking at myself and came out, which is would have been south of my location. And there it was. There was just a huge shift just started going by. It had to be great with that field from my cycle that great over the years, but it had to be that big 6 or 7 stories tall, faded green lights on the side, maybe 4, I believe. And then the traveling, there was no adverse effects for me, like, you know, my watch was still in. The other generator out there had a story, so there was nothing done electronically. I looked across the street at my neighbor, who was head of federal freedoms for the whole western part of the United States. And he overdid all he like that, it just shot off to the west. That was it. It was gone like a bullet. It was just like it didn't even exist. It was just gone. So after that, I started looking into it. You know, that I called DPS, the Department of Public Safety. I called all radio stations, TV stations, Sheriff's Department, Highway Patrol, Davis Mountain Air Force Base, the Air Force. I called everybody I could think of that would have the right for this stuff. Nobody saw it. And then I never got one report. So the total of seven of us were all losing minds, I guess. So I went into looking into UFOs. And getting nowhere fast, just accumulating a lot of things in the book. I just gave it up and went to business next. And we moved back to Pennsylvania and to watch TV when I made a show about UFOs. So it didn't get me. And that was the start of it. It was me. So I've been over 30 years ago, so it's, mobile units and a team and a huge library. And shortly we're going to be doing environmental DNA testing. So it's come a long way. It has come a long way from that exciting out there. But I enjoy every minute of it. I'm retired. I love it. It's fun. I get to meet a lot of interesting people. I get to meet a lot of people that I think should have.
Butch, over the last 25, 30 years that you have been doing this, you've seen a real change in the paranormal UFO community, the cryptid community as well. I'm just curious, for you, out of your last 30 years of doing this, what has been the biggest factor of the changes that you've seen, for the good and for the bad?
Well, I'll go with the good first, and that's a lot of younger people are getting involved, and a lot of females are getting involved, which was unheard of years back. I mean, if you found two or three women that were involved in UFO studies or anything like that, I mean, they were more leaning towards the paranormal, but as far as UFO, the cryptozoology stuff, not they were around. Those are some of them, and they're very good at what they do. They have more patience, let's put it that way, where, you know, you're out there with a bunch of guys sitting in the woods and pretty soon everybody getting all antsy. You know, they want to get a go for smoke, they want to get a beer, they want to do this, want to do that. Where, you know, the women are just, they set their mind to what they're supposed to be doing and they do it. I find the same thing whether it's cryptozoology, the paranormal, or Bigfoot, or your boat. One of the things I guess the bad part is that there's over the years, I would say it's probably the last 15 years. There were so many people got involved in this, basically via the TV shows, you know, the monster hunters and the monster killers and the UFO chasers and all that stuff. And, you know, they copied everything they saw on TV, they put it to the world, then they took it to their group, and it just became a mainline. And with these groups, they lasted, you know, a week or 2 years or even a day. Got their hats from New Jersey and stuff, and then they pop it in, so they start another group from New House, New Jersey, so that the Jersey crowds get the fortune out of it. But one of the things that has happened is that the people that are really interested, that really are looking and really are looking for answers, and are out there doing what they can, or joining groups that do that, it's really phenomenal in my mind, because if I had to come up, 10 years ago, if I had to come up to 5 people in my life, I'd be hard put. And now it's like, you know, I can make a phone call, I can get 20 guys together, no problem. If I need information from Cuba, I can get it. If I need questions answered from Florida, I can get it. So you over time, you make connections with people that are really doing the right research the right way. And then the other part of it is we really do get to help a lot of people with your research, whether it's what kind of equipment you use, or background research on your case, or trying to help them put together what they got, or trying to make a good report. And there's just a whole lot of little things come together So it's been a lot more interesting, I'd say, in the last 50 years. But we're more involved, you know, it's not like it's a private group running around doing whatever we do to keep it totally secret. We do a lot of stuff with folks. Somebody wants something researched, I'll bring research. You know, I'll do it. We don't charge anybody anything. So it's been pretty good. And like I said, a lot of young people get involved, and it's really cool there because they know how to use a computer, they know how to use a camera, they know how to, you know, there's things that they know that the old printers never did. I mean, you know, half these guys go to a UFO watch, sky watch, or even you take them outdoors.
I gotta ask you, what was it like 30 years ago going into the field and having to carry cannabis with you?
That was really tough. It's really changed a lot over the years. But like I said, the biggest transition is that really happened in the last 15, 10 years that things have changed where people that are involved, let's put it this way, people that are involved really want to be involved. They just don't go down to the local bar, grab a beer, and tell everybody about their great experience out in the woods chasing Bigfoot. So it's really good that all these people finally have, you know, come out to the river after all these years, and we do anything we can to help them. And they've been a great help to us too, especially when it comes to if you're doing something in an area you're not familiar with, and you know, you can get a hold of somebody who knows somebody or whatever. What used to be, is this the building they're talking about? Is this the creek or the river they're talking about? Is this where this alleged sighting took place, etc.? So it works out for both of us.
Okay, so what about the difficulties of the field over the last three decades?
The BS guy, the fortune growing, the glory crowd, they're kind of little down, they were out there maybe 10 years ago, 15 years ago. Never saw a UFO, never any cryptids watch, adventures, kinds of adventures. But they wrote books, they made TV appearances, they made at the conference, the conference crowd. And it was fortune glory. A lot of people don't know this, but the same thing with the green bag, the dog bag, the green bag, the UFO study. Never saw a UFO in his life. Never. When he told me that, I came to him, he almost fell on the floor. I said, wow, you've got to be kidding me. He said, no, never saw one in my life. And he knew a lot. He did a lot of research, and of course, a lot of stuff in the eyes, stuff like that. Never saw one in his life. So it's just like he said, I went to hit you in the butt, and I wouldn't know the difference. I said, there's a law if one hits you in the butt, you wouldn't know the difference. So I think that was the bad part about it. That time was for glory, getting your own TV show, doing your own radio show, which years back, they were all over the place. There were radio shows everywhere. Right here, in the town where I live, this area, there were two shows. One was on the Sunday night, and the other was on Wednesday. And they were both on the UFO and cryptozoology and stuff like that. Oh, that's cool, one of those guys. He never left the street, but he was an expert. And that's where it really gets me when they start saying, look, there are no experts in ufology. There are no experts in cryptozoology, and there are no experts in the paranormal. What we find, we find. What we miss, we miss.
Butch Witkowski is joining us tonight on Space Out Radio. I got to ask you, Butch, in regards to the way the field has changed as we enter a new year here, the second year that we've had with COVID going on, and hopefully it doesn't last too much longer because I think we're all going a little stir crazy and cannot wait to eliminate the word COVID from our vocabulary. I got to ask you, how do you think this is going to affect the entire phenomena world for researchers in?
Well, I know that's affected by things. We can't run around like we used to. The last places are closed, we can't get into them. I think once it opens up, and people become more comfortable and have a shot at whatever it's supposed to be. I don't see anything changing with the day-to-day conferences or emails or telephone calls that we go through with everybody. But, you know, there probably is going to be some changes, but I really don't think a whole lot of change because, you know, you got two or three people out in the vehicle and out in the woods. That doesn't affect it because you're not working on it. The conferences, you can count on those being shut down for a long time. You can see the conference crowds going to find something else to do. Maybe they like to grab a bit of an outdoor or something like that. Or, you know, they're going to do things back to what they're doing. So I think that's the only way that I'm going to be able to find some of those people. So every conference that I know that's booked for this year, for 2021 and in 2020, they're all canceled. And they're all done.
Okay, so do you see it affecting the way the UFO talk does their research again this year? Because last year, because of lockdowns, you couldn't get to where you needed to go.
The places that we couldn't go to were kind of places that were public and they were shut down. A couple of them were at state parks, they were shut down. There was some private land that we couldn't get on to because people were afraid of the virus and stuff like that. But even that stuff loosened up. I mean, we've got a couple of things for which we need to get that. It affected us to a point, but in the meantime, we got to do a lot of, you know, gathering the stuff together as far as reports, all the reports, new reports, equipment needs that was done. I worked out of business, environmental being done. I just think it was really good, but nothing that won't be transcribed in the next month.
I'm kind of asking, in regards to the new people who have come into the field, what are some of the mistakes that they are making that you recognize maybe back in the day that you made as well? Because there's always people interested in getting into this field, they just may not know how.
Well, I think the early mistakes that I made were going out loud. That was a big mistake. I didn't really realize, you know, in the very beginning when supply to fund to get gear up and take off. And when I got there, I was like, you know, there's things running around here that could eat me in a minute. I thought I could fall and break a leg and just take it away to die. A lot of mistakes with equipment, you know, I tried to always go the cheapest route, and that didn't work out too well. That was just a waste of time and money. Another thing that wasted time on, I think, was a lot of books that were pretty much one guy wrote a book and three other guys copied from that book, which just changed the wording or they changed the substance of the book. But it's, I think that was pretty much it. I think when people, if they just put in their head that when they go out into the field, I don't think they need to care if they're star watching, they're going to go out and about to go to star watching. Just be careful in the way that people know where you're at. You know, have the proper equipment with you. Always carry a cell phone. And then, you know, anything on the cell phone I carry would like a brick. But, I don't know what you might call myself. That's kind of the simple stuff. You know, just being wise, streetwise for where you're going. Like, I would never go to British Columbia without grabbing you guys. There's no way I'd walk out in those woods. And the very first thing I'm going to tell you is always find somebody who can run around slower than I can.
Interesting. Okay. So, do you think then that the mistakes of young people are learning is good for the field right now? Because when you're not in social media, when you're not even a little bit of a, I hate to say, a know-it-all attitude, because none of us know it all, but there is ego that goes along with that. When you combine ego with, you know, everything, how does the field from where you started compared to today when people start today?
Well, when people start today, you have, they're found in mind, and I can't speak for anybody, but on, like, say, ParaNexus, with strictly myself and other researchers, have been around for a long time. The ones that are serious will contact you and they want to have a lot of questions, you know, like they don't want to take their time, they don't come to the house. Along the same way, you know, and the guys up in Western Pennsylvania, which is big for areas off of the Chester Bridge and stuff. I mean, they want to share what they're looking for. At the same time, they want you to share with them what they should be doing and what they shouldn't be doing. And that to me, was one of the biggest things, because people have been hurt. There was a guy killed a few years back. On the Paranormal one, where he went into the old house and, you know, didn't tell anybody he was going. He just went into the old house and he found him the next day, went through the floor and took the basement from the second floor. So that was the end of that. So I always tell, I'll tell anybody anything they need to know. If I have something I can share with them, I can email it to them or tell it to them. We do a lot of picture research for folks. We don't charge anything for that. The DNA stuff, we won't get that started probably until March or April. And another thing we're looking into is a scanner, a 3D scanner, which I can use in the field, plug into a laptop. I can scan a footprint and send it to you by email. That quick. No transfer powers, no nothing. Just scan it, ship it.
Come on, you got a fax that's going to be there somewhere.
No, I don't. I don't own one. Seriously.
Why do I doubt that? Why do I doubt that?
I'm serious. I do not own a fax machine. I have no use for it. I can do everything on a computer. What do I need a fax machine for?
I know. I'm just saying today's technology, Jimmy, considering you're still investigating with a habitat, so I wasn't sure.
I still got to figure out how that works. I can't find the place on the top button.
Mm-hmm. Right?
Yeah. Right.
That's the way it works. We've got about 90 seconds here before we have to go to break. The bottom of the hour, Butch Witkowski, Springs, Days, continues here. Butch, I'm curious, in regards to going into 2021 here, what do you look forward to doing?
Just getting back out of the field. I mean, somebody told me the weather is going to be about 50 tomorrow. I'm at the point now where I'm crazy. I've got to get out to see. There's so many places I need to go, there's so many places I want to check out. There's like four caves that I want to get into. And so I'm just ready to go. I got the food with.
I don't blame you. You know, I mean, we just got to get through this winter first here, and I'll tell you, we actually have had a little bit of a mild winter here, so I think over the next couple of weeks, we may absolutely try and get back out and see if we can find some prints in the snow.
Oh, yeah. That's a big thing.
Yeah, that's going to be real big. Which I'm going to need you to hold on right there, because we are going to go to break here at the bottom of the hour. Butch Witkowski's Strange Days continues on Space Out Radio. It happens the first week, of every month, where we've been breaking, talking about all these monsters and everything that's running all over the place. UFOcop.com is Butch's website. Make sure you check it out. We'll be back with more Space Out Radio right after this. Just so you guys know, on the audio, my main chat is listening in on it. We seem to have some sort of divide. I don't know why. That some of you are hearing the audio that is coming through muffled. Others are not having an issue with it. I don't really know what's happening here with the audio and why it's so split like that. We are checking into it right now, and Chuck is reading the comments that you guys are leaving. So if you have any issues on why it's maybe not send it. I don't know. Maybe it's the I know a lot of you are listening on your phones. I know a lot of you have web browsers up on your laptops or whatever. I'm not sure what is going on, but we're working on it. It might be, don't forget too, it might be network issues in certain areas where you are located as well. Hey, Craig Priest, how you doing, man? Good to have you back. Slim, thanks for coming in. Michael Lestuka, welcome. What do you see here? Hey, Raul. Android, it only works with headphones. Well, we haven't changed any encoding on this end whatsoever. Hey, ufologist, how are you? Welcome. We haven't changed anything on anything. So, all we did was boost the levels up a little bit. And it's just kind of weird that some people are having issues and it's weird. We will have Gorgon's intelligent just in the theory. Hey, Jim. Yeah, so I don't know what's happening with some of your audio out there. It might be Wi-Fi issues, but for the most part, it seems like it's off and on for a lot of people here tonight, and I don't know why. And it might be like we've had a cut here that he's in the news right now, and he's saying that it's sounding good. Maybe a network latency, we're not sure. Dark Hour, how you doing? So, I don't know your high season place. JP Bay Senior, how are you? Audio good in Arkansas. I know it's Arkansas, I just like saying Arkansas. Hey Jay, what's going on? How are you doing? We've got about 90 seconds before we come back with Butch Witkowski. And it's something half an hour to swim. There it is. TH says, if you're listening via YouTube on your phone apps, update your app. That might be what's happening. Maybe your app needs updating. Good point. Thank you for pointing that out, TH. Really appreciate that. Laptops? I don't know. You should be listening on your station, Anselman. It sounds perfect. Perfect. Touch Sloth, how are you? Welcome to our chat room for the first time. And I want to say a big thank you to Chuckleham, the gorgeous Kira, Big Dog, TH, and Cat Chaser for those awesome super chats tonight. Thank you so much for the love and support. And I don't know what it is with the audio. All I know is that half of you are having great audio, the other half are not hearing it well on YouTube. It's nothing we have done on this end. All we did was boost up the sound from yesterday. Otherwise, we haven't touched anything. Try updating your app. I don't know. Maybe Microsoft has come up with another. Okay, here we go. Space and Radio is down underway. My name is Dave Scott. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us. We really do appreciate it. I want to remind you that if you miss portions of this show or others, check out our free archives by going to youtube.com/spacedownradio. Just do old baby the favor and hit that subscribe button on the website at spacedownradio.com, where we have a plethora of features for you, including Rock Night Bumblefoot and reading up on Captain Success of our newsline. Follow us on Twitter at spacedownradio and on Instagram at spacedownradio7. We continue on with Butch Witkowski's Strange Days tonight, which is website ufotalk.com. He's known as being one of the craziest men in the field of ufology, cryptozoology, paranormal, and being from Pennsylvania as well. Butch, welcome back.
What's that?
I'm Jackson. How are you doing, my friend?
I'm doing just fine, sir. It sounds good here. I mean,
but I also want to remind people here, so my throat is a little scratchy. I noticed recently that I've come down with a little bit of an allergy, and that is a pet thing. And so I was sitting on my couch, and my dogs sneak up on my couch on the phone. So if I sound a little, how can you say, a little congested and not sick, it's this darn pet woman that has just beaten the fuck out of me recently. And you can say, I don't know. But that's what's going on. That is what's going on. But I want to get to the sightings of these Mothmen. I mean, your buddy Ron Strickler keeps looking into. What is actually going on with these Mothmen?
Are you talking about the Chicago
stuff? Yes.
Well, you know, it started a couple of years ago, and it wasn't this one, it was a couple of them, it didn't really amount to much. But then they just started coming in one after the other after the other. I've done the case and everything. I've been to the group, according to what I did some background research on the underground of Chicago, which is huge, by the way. Well, I see it there being a place where, you know, they did investigate the world and things kind of like that. There are a lot of places you can still get to the underground in Chicago. It's from the ship, sort of shut off, and, you know, page it up. But when I read those reports, I mean, it's just nuts. I mean, you got constants there, you've got a group of people on a tour bus that's there. I have no idea what they are. I mean, the descriptions are always in the room, but everybody's trying to see the same thing. I don't know. And they seem to hang around water like the lake. I don't know. I really don't know what they are. I mean, you know, people have said, they're going to be a guy down the pole, and they're down the pole, and they're going to say that. Well, those animals were huge. And then another thing is that when they say they're on the ground and they just take off, no. Prehistoric birds like that just didn't take off. They were too big or too heavy. So they always landed on it, stayed on it. You know, when they flew, they just jumped off the top of the mountain or off the cliff or whatever to get up in altitude. There was no way they could stay on the wherewithal to just take a limit leap and jump in the sky. So, I mean, there are so many larger birds out there that, you know, you can see some misidentification from them, but you can't see misidentification from all of them. I mean, that's a bug. But, I'm at a loss for that. I can't wrap my head around it because there's just so many reports. I don't know what they are now. It's over 100. I know it's over 100. They got good researchers out there with opinion. They interview people right away. So, hopefully, one of them will find their buildings falling around. Some of them are not going to solve their interest. But I don't know. I just don't know what they are. And they don't really fly all that common. most of the reports I saw that have been that kind of a high, sort of like, you know, 1,000, 2,000 feet. Now, 1,500, 2,000 feet, you know, everything looks big. You know, especially 172 looks big. So, I don't know. I honestly don't know what to say about this. We're seeing on the ground. We're seeing that, you know, pretty regular people, lawyers have seen them, doctors have seen them, cops have seen them, security guards at the airport have seen them, but some pilots have seen them. What they are, who knows? I mean, you know, there's so many things in this world that are out there that we don't even have a clue. You know, that's just like the guy said to me the other day, he said, well, the reason you don't see Sasquatches because, well, you don't want to find Sasquatches. Sasquatch, oh my god, my Sasquatch. Is because they get in my face. And I think through it, I thought myself, well, you know, I don't feel like doing the most of it. Well, I screwed him up for a week. I think it's just, I just made it nuts. I don't know what, I know every researcher out there is worth the stuff. No, but all this is connected. This is all connected. And I think this is what I was doing. UFOs, everything is connected. You know, trying to get my history to put it all together. I think that's a pretty good job.
I gotta ask you, okay, because I'm a big fan of your buddy Ron, and when your Ron speaks to me about something, I usually listen because I think over the years we've built a relationship where there isn't a lot of BS in that. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, there's a lot of honesty. You're not going to pull the wool over my eyes. There's no need to. So my question to you is, how does Ron or and his 14 group seem to get all of these reports on these sightings, yet you don't see any other researchers getting these reports? It's a little confusing to me.
Well, that's clearly not true. There are other individuals in the Chicago area that are getting reports. They're attached to MUFON and other groups. They deny everything. You know, like, it's not happening. This is, it's all, you know, just to put on by one of these people. But that stuff goes way back. Ron's one of those guys that has always and always will tell them like it is. So if somebody starts to snowball, you know, look out. If he's like that, he puts it all together. You're in big trouble. And you're not afraid to put that there either. The thing that's out there, they're all long-time researchers. They've been around for many, many years. They know what they're doing. They know how to do these things. They know how to interview people. They'll jump in their vehicle and go right to the spot to take the time to report now. In 10 minutes, they do it in their work. You have a handful out there that even when they have really good cases, even when they have really good cases, they shelved them, or they lost them, or they didn't mean anything. So, it's that old thing with, well, you got reports from British Columbia, but Butch, I don't have any cases in British Columbia, so three cases in British Columbia, hey, stop, you gotta be jumped. I'm the real deal. Thank God, not by a lot, only by a few. But they really get on it. I mean, there's the photographs. I mean, some of the photographs you look at them, you throw them up, you know, it is what it is. And that's what the guy said he saw, and that's what the picture was saying he saw. But there are a lot of pushback from a group of people who said, because they're not getting the reports. And Ron gets a lot of reports because he's been doing it for a long time, and everybody's familiar with phantoms and monsters. I mean, his research goes all over the world. I've been involved in some stuff with him in Australia, New Zealand, I mean, you know, places that I never would have gone in my own. never really heard anybody saying anything about me. Never. If there was something derogatory, said about what he does or how he does it, well, he thinks if we can do better, do it. But we were following his numbers on his website. Crazy. I didn't get into this paranormal, I didn't get into this cryptozoology stuff until I met Ron. We started with with one case and one good other case, and he scared me more than once with his stories. So it's just the way it is today. I mean, you almost know right off the get go what you can do with the dream team. You can tell when somebody's interested, or they have a legitimate question, or they're looking for help. I mean, you just know it. And the other one, they try to slide in on you, or they think, they get somebody else to slide in on you. You can tell just the way they ask the question, no researcher that I know of. I would tell them and say, you got this report, this UFO report, I have something similar. Give me the name of your contact so I can call. Nobody would do that. Nobody. So when somebody asks you that, you just go right away. The nice department, they have a nice place, but I click. Now, if you're working on it together, if I was working on a case with you in British Columbia, you were working on a case with Buffalo. That's a different story. But if I just called you out of the blue and wants all the information, he wants the contact, the phone number, the address, exactly what happened, but you have half the phone screen out by a click.
Okay, so the law is taking a lot of crap over this. He's old enough to been in this game long enough to kind of know that comes with the territory. But do you think it's because of the creature that it is that maybe there isn't enough respect that kind of goes along with what he's doing regarding this information, because he seems to be right on top of it?
Well, I think the respect comes with his honesty over all these many years. And he's been doing it for such a long time. Everybody knows the guy. And like I said, he takes cases all over the world. I can't do that. There's no way I can do that. He has contacts all over the world. But, when you talk about stuff that comes to the feedback, or somebody gets on your case about something, it's all about fortune and glory. You're doing something, or you found something that they will never find. I mean, if they did find it, they wouldn't know what to do with it to begin with. It's a live show. And these fields, I've watched groups, and they were good people, and they were really helpful to the people involved. But I've seen good groups just fall apart because there's groups that, well, they're getting rid of course of us, why are they getting a course of our knowledge, what are they doing, what, they got new baseball hats, we got the old ones, we need the new radio. They should get married. They'd have less arguments. Well, not really.
No, I can understand that and appreciate that. How can I put this? Because I trust him, but I kind of want to see the other side of it. And I'm going to play devil's advocate here on it. Because with this creature that is being seen, Ron doesn't live in the area. So where are these reports coming from? And how are they filtering to him?
They're coming through his website, based on monsters. That's where he's different. Or they're going direct to some of the researchers out there on their own websites. The other guy has a radio show also, and he's investigated in his life. And they get them, and then they share them with him. That's where he gets somebody who has really shares in the meeting with those guys. So, right now, I'm curious. Four or five out there working, and they've been held since day one. When you document me, one UFO sighting or one cryptid sighting or one type of animal event. That's one thing. When you're doing 5 or 6 or 10 a day, that's crazy. And that's the way it happens out there sometimes. The minute they get like a drive through, just like everything else, there's nothing happening, and the fire suddenly explodes again, and you're off and here.
So this Mothman, sightings that Mothman has reported on, the creature that is being seen, how similar is it to the creature that was seen in Point Pleasant, West Virginia, back 50 years ago?
I don't think that it's very close at all, because the description that I've seen of unreported, it's more, everybody kind of says, you know, it's got a long group, it's got a long tail, it's got membrane wings, splendor. They're describing each other, they're describing something that is ancient, very ancient. It's not like with the Point Pleasant sightings, you have people that are describing of a car standing there with no shape and a big red eye and massive wings and stuff like that. I mean, that's not what they're getting at. They're getting things that, if you pull up a picture of a website, that's what they're seeing. That's what they're reporting. Now, they all have some hoaxes. Don't get me wrong, but they don't make up the data right away. But there's so many things out there that we don't know about. I mean, I'd be surprised if somebody would ever walk up to you where you live and say, "Hey, I know everything that's in these woods." I could just drop my head with the fucking device. Nobody knows what's in those woods. I mean, there was a thing on the other day. I just caught a little bit of it, but it had to do with British Columbia. The cryptozoologist, and he was checking out things or something like that. And he said, "I could spend a lifetime in the woods here." And he said, "If I had to wear the ball and I'd clear up all these trees and move all these woods off to the side, he said, I'd probably have more discoveries than anyone I've ever had in my life." And I said to myself, that's a lot of trees, buddy. You put them over and shop. I mean, it's like, British Columbia is very strange to me. Because we have mountains here, we have large forests here, but they're flat, we don't have a lot of mountainous ecosystems. When you get only 1 minute to the other side, there's a city. You go the other way, you go over that side of the mountain, there's a small town. I mean, it's built up, there's a lot of folks. But the guy showing over there to British Columbia, I mean, it's probably not a good thing to throw the trees and a few spots over there, and I'm like, you need a good luck.
I have 500 lakes in a 1 hour span of driving around me.
Oh, my.
Yes.
See, now here we have more larger streams, creeks, smaller rivers. There are some large rivers, of course. We have a lot of lakes, but not that many. They're all over the state. And then the very largest ones we have are all man-made lakes. So, in my book, they don't count because, somebody says there's people off this monster going down through the lake. So I'm thinking, how did they get in there? How did they get in there? It's a landlocked lake. And they made it. But people have to take into account when they're doing research. What they're going to get themselves into, right? Before we get to these caves, I spent months researching these caves. I have diagrams of them, maps, and I think they are, things I should be wary of, things I should look out for. That's what you have to do. I just can't take the words of somebody and think that, I was in that cave when I was 13 years old as a Boy Scout. And then I looked it up, and it took a blast, 20 years ago. But it's getting even more interesting now that we're starting to do things a little more scientific, like the 3D scan and we can get that information. I can send that to you. I can send a picture to you, Jeff Melvin, but anybody else, well, I'd say anybody who wants to send a picture, send it immediately. That'll help them. The environmental being that just fascinates me because, you're taking a sample of water. If anybody were to start to look at all the reports that they have, essentially course of control reports, and look at the area that they report from, so I would guarantee you that within a short distance, there is water.
Interesting. Well, it's going to be interesting then, because everything needs water to live.
Right.
So, can we be surprised by that?
It's going to go better. It's going to go wrong. You know, they're good because they just. They're interdimensional. So if they're interdimensional, they don't need to eat straight or anything else. Then you have the other thing, which is the flesh and blood, they need food, they need to eat, they need to drink, they need shelter, etc. Until we find what we're looking for, these people can talk back and forth to each other and close their mind to the other person, or just close their mind to that person regarding what they think it is. Until we find what we're looking for, or we can prove that the case was in the life we've seen, we could have seen, that's the life we've seen. That's the life we could have seen. Or, the footprint that runs all the way across the field, covered with fresh snow, and 50 yards out, it's done. In the middle of the field, where did he go?
Well, that's amazing. Where are they going? How are they just disappearing?
Yeah, exactly. And there's so much to look into it. There's just so much stuff that you've got to put together when you're looking at your report. There's so many things that pop into your head, if you had said to me 20 years ago about interdimensional travel, or Bigfoot being connected to UFOs or Paranormal, or vice versa, or whatever the one is called, I'd have just said, you're crazy. They're all separate. But for all these years, I've they're not all separate, because I've had UFO sightings that turned into cryptid sightings, I've had UFO sightings that turned into entity sightings, I've had entity sightings that turned into Paranormal events, so it's all connected. I've said that now for years, and I will continue to say it. So, when people go out, they're looking for certain traits, like they go out, they're looking for the bipolar cannon, they're looking for the Bigfoot, they're looking for the paradox of the stuff. What they should be looking for is something that shouldn't be there. That's what they need.
What do you mean by that? Save that thought, because we are going to go to break here at the top of the hour. Butch Witkowski has strange things happens to kick off the final week of every month. Butch's website, ufortop.com. We're going to be talking monsters. What's good evidence? What are we looking for? How should we approach a good investigation? We'll be back right after this. I'm a boss, I'm just going to run my dogs out. I'll be right back, okay?
How much time do you have?
6 minutes.
All right, good. I need to make it.
I'm going to close the door. Thank you. Thank you for your support for social media. Otherwise, it's been a nice session. We see that the space that we're able to investigate cases, play out, and the rest of the world is the point. We are independent, and there's no connection to what we do. I want to give you a story. The spider is happy together, and the rest of the world is something to support.
Target is always on, the most than Cooper. The most than Cooper is where you want to be when visiting Canada's West Coast. Open until 2 a.m. nightly, the most cranks up the road while serving some of the best rated food in the city. the Moose starts at 695. What part of anyone else in Vancouver when the Moose is right there? Get your horns up and rock with the Moose. The official party part of the space opera.
What to do, what to do.
Boy, now we've got a bundle of stuff.
4 million is still very limited to 200,000. Don't look for one such that's going to be 3 million. Don't even bundle of stuff. Don't even come to make the bundle of stuff. And afraid of the sun and sun and
everything. Space on that. Bundle of baby. Bundle of stuff. Give it to the baby. Give it to the baby. Give it to the baby.
This is Amber Beckman, and I want to invite you to subscribe to our YouTube channel, where we store all of the SOR solar archives for free. And as an added bonus, every 2 weeks, I'm posting premium content on cryptid channels. If you're ready to learn some exclusive legends and buzzwords around the world, and tell the stories that go with them, find us at youtube.com/spacedoutradio, and check out Cryptid Tales today. Drop a comment and let me know when you will begin. See you there.
Hey, space fans, this is John Rayleigh with the Tucson Show. If you know anything about our website, you know that we like to do things a bit differently. We're not some useless organization collecting money for anything that's going to be. I don't know if you're collecting things like the Greek models. If you need to give those items directly to an underbuddy, you know. To become a donor to Space Out Radio, the official charity, Child Charities, just go to charitychurch.com. We are scouring the grid for the most intriguing stories of the day. Take the time to read up on the SOR newsletter, where you too, led by Captain Flint, will be looking to use some of the best paranormal and supernatural news. Or there are some stories that will blow your mind from the weird to the wacky. It's the news outside of the news that piques interest, and that's what we're looking to do with our channel. The SOR newsletter, and race.media.com.
Some full space business. All you have to do is head over to our website and click on the SOR button. You will be able to click your business and click on what you need more. T-shirts, things, hats, coffee mugs, you name it, we can get it for you. So do yourself and be supporting the story for you. If you're supposed to read it, it's better to get SOR button today.
For the price of one cup of coffee a month, you can become a SOR space traveler. The Space Travelers Club is a place where I can interact with other listeners, even more enjoying the show, and I have great fun. We actually have a very great time to talk to you about this. Just like the video is giving you, I'm just going to ask you, and you guys will forget about this. We have talked with everything that's wrong. The Space Travelers Club is going to follow our team, and Space Travelers is going to we all know on Space Travelers Radio, a good beard and mustache. So ParaNexus created an official beard with way loose beard around. Made in Canada, we're taking care of beard and stashes around the world. We use 100% natural ingredients with affordable buttons to make your wrist and feet silky smooth. Use promo code SOR2015 at waitingloosebeard.com today.
Once again, I know some of you are having sound issues. I don't know why. My sound on my cell phone and on our end is completely fine. I'm not sure what is happening on some of your ends. Hi, Paul. How are you doing? Hey, Benjamin. How are you doing, Bob? So, I'm not sure what's happening on your end, maybe you have to update your cell phone or something along those lines. You know that sometimes we have audio issues when our computers need to be updated. Hello to UFOs, how are you, buddy? So I don't know really what is going on. I can say that it is not on our end. We've done a couple of phone checks already tonight. Hi, Tony Brown. Excuse me. So, I apologize for any of you having some issues. maybe in Fort Wayne. Like I said, I don't know. What I do know is that our studio here, we're having a great sound coming through, and I checked my cell phone during the break. Yeah, how are you doing? Thank you for joining our chat room. We're on in 20 seconds here with number two with Butch Witkowski. And he's here. Good to see you. And if you have any questions, please, please put them in the chat button or something. Thank you, guys. 5 seconds. Hour number two of Space Out Radio is underway tonight. My name is Dave Scott. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us today. We welcome back everyone listening to number 24 affiliates around North America, digitally on Talkstream Live, KPNL, and Revolution Radio. If you want to check out all of our free archives, go to youtube.com/Space Out Radio. Just do me the favor, hit that subscribe button. But if you're planning to set the password for tonight, Amy is the one our space travelers club. Temple missile. Or is it the promissile? I don't know, but the plan sets the password each and every night right here on Space Out Radio. Our website is spacedoutradio.com, where we have a plethora of features for you, including rocking out the Bumblefoot and reading up our captain search and so on newsletter. Follow us on Twitter at Spaced Out Radio and on Instagram at Spaced Out Radio Show. We continue on here on Space Out Radio with Butch Witkowski from UFOTalk.com. Butch joins us near the end of each month for Strange Days, where we get into all the weird, strange happenings from North America and the world. Butch, welcome back.
Yes, sir. Good to be back.
Investigation techniques, as we get into those, does it matter on how you investigate, whether it's UFOs, paranormal, or cryptids? Is there a difference?
Yeah, there's different equipment used for all three. UFOs, basically, what it tend to do in my watch. The one that is more equipment, or is the, anything cryptozoology. We have big changes that have taken place over the last 10 years. The use of thermal imaging device, which are pretty much down to a couple hundred bucks that you can attach to your hand around here, which is great. That might be all the complaints, source, and fluids. Then you have night vision goggles or night vision scope. Trail cams, of course, have gotten really sophisticated. The ones we have that we are using are Wi-Fi. So whenever there's two doors, we can have a laptop in the computer and in the truck. And then you have recorders, remote speakers, not phones yet on the drones, because you really need to know what you're doing when those things are very expensive. And really, when you're high up and looking down, you're not going to see nothing but a lot of trees or brush coming up in the back of 20 years. Investigation techniques with UFOs are pretty standard. You know, when you're watching the sky, you've got a star map, so you know what you're doing. If you're using a one that you can hook your camera to, digital camera, not a cell phone, digital camera. They make it that easy to scroll on things and then you just, you know, attach your camera to it and you can visualize what's going on in the sky. Or you can buy a Skycam. Skycam, they're not really that outrageous. I've seen them as low as $250. Where it's a camera that faces upward, it mounts on top of your tripod. What we have has a heater in it, so it doesn't get followed up with the on-call word or departure change. So just use strip lines. So you're getting like a fishbowl shot of the sky. And it's all big things for
seem to have lost you there, Butch. I mean, one second now. It seemed to have lost you. I don't know where Butch went. Weird. I could call him right there, sir. Seems like I'm dead here, man. Let's see if we can get this connection going. Oh, the power didn't go out, or the phone didn't go out, or something. Weird. I like the voice though. Well, I mean, hey, sometimes this happens, sometimes it doesn't. It's the beauty of live radio when, all of a sudden, it is a test because of the phone line. Sometimes the battery weight runs out, sometimes it leaves. You never know. You never know what's going on. We'll try and get any books back here momentarily. But like we were saying right off the bat here with investigative techniques, I think the important part is that people need to realize they don't have to spend a lot of money on gear. A lot of times your own intuition is all you really need. You know, along with a digital voice recording, a big camera, take some photos. You know, there just seems to be way too much interference right now with people spending thousands of dollars of times in order to bring their investigation techniques up to par. So, I mean, it's just amazing out there how many people are spending money, dedicating money, to do something that is, in fact, for most people, a hobby. And granted, hey, there's a lot of people who waste a lot of money on doing things that they don't need, whether it's video games, whether it's train sets, whether it's Hot Wheels cars or toys or board games or, you know, new outdoor toys. Some people like boats, ATVs, so on. And we're going to continue to do that, because that's what we enjoy. But that being said, when it comes to ghost hunting equipment, especially when we don't really know if it actually works, even cryptid type equipment, you know, we have to be careful with what we're spending our money on. So, I mean, I find that very interesting. I find that very interesting indeed that many people out there are trying to, you know, spend a lot of money on the technology that really hasn't been proven up to this date. It really hasn't. So I'm not sure if that's a good thing or a bad thing, or maybe it's just something that is a little convoluted, because let's face it, we always like to have the best and the biggest. You know, we want to be that person who can show off our new toys. We want to be that person. But we don't have to be. Like, for instance, I'm not an investigator. I really am not. But when I go out in the field, I'm going by the feel of everything. I'm going by the feel I have of everything that is going on. It's true. I'm going by where I feel I need to go. I know that I've been going by where I need to see things. I'm going by my own intuition. So it's very strange to me when everything is going on, when I see people wasting literally hundreds of dollars, thousands of dollars, and sometimes we don't even have that money. Sometimes they don't. And here they are, wasting it, because, you know, they're still paying for rent. Or still paying for toys before they would pay for rent. Right? I think Butch's phone is dead, to be honest. Or something is happening. Definitely not, because I'm sitting to reach him on my cell phone right now. I'm playing. Thanks to him. Alone. See? I'm trying to get him. Yeah. I don't know what's going on. Butch, look, that's the last hour or something. But we'll continue on here. We'll continue on. I'll space that right now, because that's what we have to do on this show. We continue on, so if you have any questions in our chat rooms, please throw them on in capital letters, and we will get to your questions momentarily. I'm going to do my best to answer them. So if you guys want to do that, I would be appreciative. And otherwise, we'll just continue on here on Space Out Radio. We will do that. I love it. Everybody, it's the MID, Men in Black, not Butch out. No, I don't think so. No, I don't think so. Well, big thing too is, how do you do your study? Well, the first thing that I try to do with anything, and this also leads to my pet peeve of the paranormal, Mr. Big Fat Creep. Yes, that is his name on YouTube. The first thing that I do is, I want to know, what is the solution I'm looking for? So, for instance, give you an example. A couple weeks ago, I got contacted by a local lady here who was having troubles with music playing in her house. She's an 82-year-old lady. She is someone who lives alone in a little cottage-type house. And the problem is, she keeps waking up in the middle of the night to music. Music being played. So, when I go into a location, even though I'm not a ghost hunter or anything like that, every day I get up trying to help people, and I'm a little, if they come. And then if I have any questions, I'll call friends of mine, like Manol and Ross and Allison and David Webby, or people like that. And I'm looking for solutions on how to cure the issue. I'm not there to play ghost hunting. I'm not there to play. For my own benefit, you gotta be there to help people. And that's probably the biggest issue that we have in this entire field. Doesn't matter whether it's paranormal or going to look for cryptids or whatever. You have to have a solution at the end. And the majority of groups that I notice out there being involved in this field and paying attention to social media is the majority of them have no idea what they're trying to do. What they're going to do with their evidence, they have no clue. After they collect their evidence and go through it, and they're like, oh, cool, look at my CBD, or oh, cool, look at this orb. What do you do with it? So the main thing is to have a solution before you do anything else. Jim is asking, would you ever consider joining a ghost hunting group? No. No, I would not. And the reason behind that is with this show, I plan to remain very neutral on everything. I will not do anything that considers any bias towards anything. And that is very difficult because I've been asked to join paranormal teams before and I've declined all of them. I've been asked to join cryptid teams. And, you know, the majority of them, like I said, you've got to have a solution before you have an answer. Okay? With the majority of teams out there, they don't know what the solution is. When they can provide a solution, we're a step closer. So, because of that, I just will not join any teams. Even if they're friends of mine, like Merle has wanted me to join his team, and I had to tell him that. Because I want to try and stay neutral between everything. That's what journalism is all about, and that's what I try and do. So, that's why I really try to stay kind of down the line. All right. We're still waiting to see if we can get back to Butch Witkowski here on Strange Days. He's over in Pennsylvania. I'm here in British Columbia. I don't know if his power went out. I don't know if he got abducted by aliens. All we know is that his phone line went dead. And we think, we'll try him in just a few minutes here as we continue on with taking audience questions here on the Spaced Out Radio. Chris Miller, has anybody remote viewed Bigfoot? Good question. I do believe in finding people who have done it. Whether they were successful or not, I don't know. I don't know. That's one of those, you know, questions that we should ask a remote viewer sometime when we have one to say. Because that would be interesting to find with the remote viewers. Who are they living? Where are they coming from? Where are they moving to? What are they feeding on? You know, if you get a high-quality remote viewer, we might be able to actually pick that up. We might be able to pick that up. I don't know if we will be able to, but it would be interesting. It would be very, very interesting to see how that works. Peter Ehlers is asking, Dave, how can I catch a Bigfoot on camera? Just a moment. Use about a 100-pound Tesla. Throw out an apple. Maybe some peanut butter on the back of your hook. And then when we come forward, just set that hook. That may not work. That may not work. You don't know. It's worth a shot, though. Totally worth a shot. At least I think so. I totally think so. But on a serious note, we have tried personally to appear with hurricanes. We can't get it. In the areas where we have had an option before, we cannot get that photograph. We tried, we're going to try again this year again, but you know, that comes to the next question, whereas a lot of long-time investigators believe that Sasquatch has the ability to potentially be able to pick out either the noise from the trail cam or see the light very quickly, or see something anomalous in the forest very quickly, even if it camouflages it. We camouflage that thing pretty good, but we just were not able to catch it. And there haven't been very successful people catching them on trail cams. Some people have got lucky, okay, but can you trust those photos? I hate to be that guy. Can you really trust those photos? And whether or not it's actually Bigfoot or something else, I do not know. You know, I really do not know whether or not you can catch it. But you got to keep trying. I mean, I know one researcher, Mike Johnson in Colorado, he has tried trail cams over and over and over again, and nothing has worked for him. Every time they go and they saw the trail cam, and they go back to that scene, the trail cam, it's either walking on the trail or something has happened to it where it's just not coming out. Not coming out at all. So, let's move on here. Another question coming from Jessica. Did Mary the Ghost return to your haunted location after the apology? Yes and no. Yes, we were able to get her returned, but she doesn't show up during the tour anymore or very often because the feeling that we get is she just doesn't trust people anymore. And that should be said. We haven't done a tour at the ghost at the museum. We haven't done a ghost tour since 2019 due to COVID. It was shut down along with some other things that kind of went on in that tour with the museum curators and us. And it got a little political. We decided that, you know, until they decide to start it, we're not going to be doing that anymore. It's just not worth our time. And, you know, sometimes they bring in people who don't really understand how the paranormal works or what it's all about. But we're fine. It's just, we don't, as of right now, we say we're not going to be doing the tour anymore. Due to some political differences, and you know what, as the biggest financial donor to the museum, that's too bad for them. That's too bad for them that they screwed it up, and they will not receive that money. We were raising almost $5,000 a year for the museum. Money that the museum needed, because this is one of the rare museums in British Columbia that does not have a government grant or sanction in regards to it. So it's a little different then, but there's nothing I can do. There's absolutely nothing I can do. And hopefully some people smarten up there, and hopefully some the annual meeting do not get elected again, because the town's in a lot of trouble for the tour. They're out about $5,000 a year because of it. Bigfoot Rob, did you hear about the $25,000 bounty put on the caps of a Bigfoot in Oklahoma? Yes. I'm not sure if that has passed through government yet, but I know they were petitioning to have a Bigfoot hunting season in Oklahoma. What I believe in this creature, I do believe that it has something supernatural going on with it. And in my opinion, we're never going to get one anyways. So is it a publicity stunt? I have no idea. I really do not have any idea whatsoever. However, I do think it's interesting. Can you imagine if somebody actually hunted and bagged and tagged a Bigfoot? Like I said, I don't think it's going to happen. However, if it did, what would that do? There are a lot of ramifications if Bigfoot is proven. A lot of ramifications. And we've discussed those on the show before. If you're just tuning in and wondering what those ramifications are, well, we have to look at it. And it's going to hurt the environment. Actually, it's going to be better for the environment. But it's going to hurt a lot of businesses. It's going to hurt the tourism business. Whether it's through hunting, whether it's through camping, fishing, it's going to be very, very intriguing to see how the logging industry is affected, potentially the mining industry, the gas industry. There's a lot of industries and blue-collar workers that are going to be affected by any type of proof that Sasquatch actually exists. Because when, and I was talking to a political person about this, when you find a new creature or you find a habitat that an endangered species is in, and if Sasquatch was proven, it would probably be listed as an endangered species because we know nothing of it. They immediately shut down that entire area. How big? I don't know. But they shut down the entire area for your scientific study of the creatures and their habitat. What are they feeding on? What are they living on? What is their migration route? Do we have bedding for them? Do they have caves? All of that needs to be shut down, and that could be shut down for years. You can't log in those areas, and a lot of people would cheer that on. But for a lot of blue-collar workers, that would cost millions of dollars. So, I mean, it's a rough two-way edge right there. Double-edged sword, I guess you call it. And I don't know how that would go over. But I don't believe they'll ever see one. So we're going to try and get Butch back after the break here. Strange Days with Butch Witkowski is going, we don't know if he was abducted by aliens. We don't know if his power went out. We're going to try and get him back. If not, we'll continue with your questions either on chat rooms or on Twitter with hashtag SpaceDogRadio. We'll be back. And then we're going to try Butch again. Phenomenon. And, you know, the fact that he hasn't posted on the chat room, I'd assume his power went out or something. That's what I'm going to assume here. So, after the break, we'll continue with your questions. We're not going to bring anyone else on, but we'll have some fun here, and we'll see some stories, and try and answer your questions as well. And then, go from there, but something. You may say something gets on me. It'll be fun. And the guys over on Twitter is probably thinking that it's all aliens and blue. Now, his phone, I'm sure Butch's phone, the way the phone line died, it almost sounded like maybe the last time or something like that. So, I'm not too concerned about it. This one's still the voice now. You probably lost from somewhere. Maybe you dropped it in the toilet. Who knows? Who knows? About 2 minutes in. 2 minutes. Yeah, he has to check this message on Facebook that I sent to him, so. It's fine. Yes, my time in 100 miles. I don't have a new storm story. That's probably what it is. Good to see you again, Sherry. Thanks for coming on in. If there is a massive solar storm hitting Earth tomorrow, all I'm saying is the sky better clear up, because that's going to make for one hell of a northern light show where I live. We don't squatch, me. I don't know what squatch means. Eric, how you doing, man? So put your questions in. A big thank you to Beehive Trinkles, to Kira, to Big Dog, to TH, and Cat Chaser for the amazing super chats tonight. Put your questions in capital letters if you have any, and I'll try and get them. The chat room is moving very fast tonight, so it's difficult for me to scroll up when we get to it, so I do apologize for saying, hey, please retype that. Hey, guys, thanks for having me. So, once again, if you're having sound issues, it is not on our end from Space Net Radio that I do know. So, it could be your phone, could be anything. It'll be awesome. We're going to get going here in about 5 seconds, everyone. The halfway point of Space Up Radio tonight. My name is David Scott. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us. we really do appreciate you and your listening ears. But I want to remind you that if you miss portions of this show or others, check out our free archives by going to youtube.com/spacedoutradio. Just do me the favor, hit that subscribe button. Our website is spacedoutradio.com, where we have a plethora of features for you, including Rock Out to Bumblefoot and reading up on Captain Church SOR Newswire. Follow us on Twitter at spacedoutradio and on Instagram at Spaced Out Radio Show. We're going to continue on with audience questions right now. I think something happened over near Butch Witkowski's house where his phone lines have gone dead. I haven't even got him on Facebook to return my message, and Butch is always very prompt on doing things like that. So until Butch is ready to come back with his phone lines on, we're going to take audience questions from one of our chat rooms or on Twitter at hashtag Spaced Out Radio. The first question comes from Friday with a Chance of UFOs. Dave, have you ever seen a UFO or had a weird paranormal experience? Explain if you don't mind. Seems I have seen a lot of UFOs. For those of you who do not know, my closest encounter came on April 10th, 2014, when I was actually called outside of a friend's house when there were a lot of strange things happening on the lieutenant for proper mission to British Columbia. And previous to going outside, I actually had a migraine headache that I realized was actually faint pulse order. It started off as a square in the front of my head, moved to the right side of my head as a triangle, left side of my head as a circle, and all of a sudden got hit with an anxiety attack that I needed to go outside. So me and my friend went outside back to this property. It was one of those nights where it was a misty, low cloud night, very damp out, and everything was dark, but you could feel the energy of certain things come around. And it was odd, very odd. So, anyways, who's calling us outside? I'm paraphrasing here. And my command, about 150 yards away, a UFO on the ground lit up the tree lines like a Christmas tree. It was the greatest white light that I have ever seen. And the one thing I remember about it was, you know, when you look into the white, if you put your head up and look into the lights, you squint. There was no squinting for this. Well, it did it three times it turned its lights off, three times it turned its lights on. And at the final time of the third time, once the lights went out, they went out for good. There was a blue cylinder standing vertically from where the white light was emanating from the bottom. And the cylinder was probably 20 to 30 feet high. And it had this black cloud that was rotating kind of clockwise on it. It would start off at the bottom and then go like halfway up and then work its way back. Honestly, it's the most beautiful blue I've ever seen. And the only reason why I know how tall it was, because the trees that separated the property where these lights were coming from were probably 60, 70 feet tall. And I know that blue cylinder went up about halfway of them. So it was pretty big. I mean, it was an amazing experience. I would love to have it happen again. I really would. Do I think I'll get that chance? I have no idea. No idea. I hope so. I would love to see it again. Jim, do you believe in the Galactic Federation? Oh, good question. Good question. There are people that I trust who absolutely believe in this. I'm not sure that I do, because it sounds a little too sci-fi and Star Wars-ish for me. I know the Twitter crowd is not going to like that because it's not enough woo and don't bring, you know, perspective into this. I get it. I may disappoint some people on this. But I really didn't see a council of aliens sitting up in the sky saying, "You are friends and you're not acting very nice." You know, I just don't see it. I don't see it. What I do see is extraterrestrials coming down here in a craft, because they probably picked up on our radio signals that are going right through outer space in all directions. And they're like, well, what are these signals? Let's go check them out. Wow, there's living beings down here. Let's go take a few. Let's go take a few. I do believe that's happening. I do believe that there are certain sectors of the government that have probably made contact one way or another. I totally get that. And I hear that. Right? But is there actually a council saying that, you know, we are not sophisticated enough as a species, so they're not going to come bring their toys down here to play with us just yet? I find that hard to believe. I really do. It sounds way too mystical to me. Chris Meyer, what is your favorite show besides your own? Are you talking Paranormal show? Let's see, who do I listen to? I listen to Tucson, a great show by him. I listen to Frank Cameron on his YouTube channel. Mostly on my time, I listen to George Murray and George Murray. But on my time, if I'm away from the studio, I probably turn everything off and get my mind about it. Normally, when I'm on YouTube, I watch a lot of YouTube, way more YouTube than I do television. I watch a magician, a magician of Montreal named Chris Ramsey. Every Wednesday, he puts out a puzzle. I just love watching these puzzles. Right. So I'll put out watch him. I like watching Mr. Beast. A bunch of young guys who go around giving away a bunch of money. I don't know how real it is or not, but they got like 51 million subscribers on the YouTube channel. And so I watch a lot of that. At night, I like getting into the weird stuff at night. So at night, I will listen to a lot of creepypasta. I listen to a lot of weird stuff like time travel, a lot of David Paulides work. But as for listening to other shows, no, I don't really listen to a lot of other shows. I don't. I'm not listening. Anyway, the matter to you, and Torrance, the booking guy, meet up. We met up for a platform called LGAB that supports us, and Torrance reached out one day and said, hey, is there anything I need to do to help you out? And I said, I need a booking guy. And he was like, well, what does it entail? And he took a couple of days to think about it. And he's like, do you mind if I have a great mustache better than yours? Is that going to be an issue? I said, no. And he sent me a picture of the mustache. I'm like, you're in. You're hired. And that's literally how we met. It was that simple. I don't know why, but it was that simple to be absolutely blunt. Sovereign Cosmic Wildman. Can you trust Canadian beef? What if it's Canada? There are cows in Canada. We have lots of cows in Canada. Our meat is grade A beef. Even McDonald's uses grade A beef. Yes, the beef is good here. Very good to eat. In fact, I'd like some beef right now. I could use some of the grade enough to put in tacos. That would be fantastic for me right now. I'd be a very happy man. Even though I have chicken tacos, no, I have chicken quesadillas for dinner. Nick, did any of you see the sharks swim behind the cage just now? There are no sharks in the studio. No sharks in the studio. I will say that. So if anybody's wondering what happened to Butch Witkowski, we don't know. All of a sudden, his phone line went dead, and it's either aliens or a power outage. Or maybe the bipedal canine broke in and hung up. Maybe it's the boogeyman. We don't know. We cannot get a hold of Butch right now. So that's why we're taking audience questions here. I'm just going to hang on out and had a big step here because a lot of times we don't get the opportunity to answer a lot of audience questions, so that's what we're doing here. I'm spaced out ready. We're going to try Butch again in the next 15 minutes or so, just to see what's going on. But if you have any questions and you're in the chat room or on Twitter, please feel free to put them in capital letters if you can. And you're in the state, do you believe that Bigfoot is a relative of the aliens? Oh, that's a good, solid question. Good, solid question. Now, the real answer is, I do believe that Sasquatch does have some sort of really cool, rule about it. I do believe that. Right? I do believe that. However, I do believe there is something supernatural about this creature. What it is, I do not believe. I do not believe that it is just flesh and blood. Right? But it is something that there's been enough experiences that I have experienced and listening to other people with their evidence and things that I've seen where I believe there is something very supernatural about Sasquatch. So, do I believe it's a relative of aliens or the fact that the planet Marduk blew up in the sky and alien ships dropped them off on Earth? No. No, I don't. But do I believe that a flesh and blood creature here on Earth? No, I do not. I think Earth has a lot of really cool mysteries that we can get into, and that we will eventually, hopefully, find out the answers to one day, because I don't believe that this creature has, I don't believe this creature is full flesh and blood. It does have something that makes it disappear. It does have, I think of the numerous times that researchers have told us that they've seen either with their own eyes or eyewitness evidence that they've received footprints just stopping in the snow. And I do not believe for a second that the creature can backtrack and make the perfect print. There would obviously be a double print in the snow or the mud, yet that is never found. So I do believe that it does have some supernatural type qualities. What they are, what they're about, I have no idea. Did they come from Marduk or Mars or someplace like that? I have no idea. No idea. What I do know is that I do believe that First Nations and Indigenous people have a reason to for their stories about this creature. And I think there's a lot more evidence there than I give it credit for. My own sighting of pixelation that I saw before getting roared at by the creature. It convinces me that there is something else to it. And what that is, I have no idea. I really don't. Same thing, Mark, in Australia. I can confirm you are alive tomorrow. Thank you for that. I was really worried. So that's the beauty of our show, having listeners all over the world, especially over in Australia, New Zealand, because we can always check in if they live in the future. We can always check in to see whether or not we are alive tomorrow. They're confirming it for us. Isn't that true? They're confirming it for us. So that works for me. Absolutely works for me. In our YouTube channel. If you're a single man with lots of beer trapped on an island, and you mate with a Sasquatch or a dog lady, what kind of question is that? I don't even drink beer. I don't. Well, the other time I do. Not very often. I wouldn't want to be on my own. Give me some ice tea. A nice ice tea. No lemon. No lemon on the side. Got to be ice cubes in there. Or crushed ice. I like crushed ice. I'm like, teammates, do you believe the aliens are already here disguised as some humans? Yes, I do. Do I have proof of that? No, I do not. But I do believe, if you are, think about it this way, put it in a reverse way. If you have the ability to fly to another planet where there is life, wouldn't you disguise yourself to look like one of them? Just so you could go hang out, go to their bars and restaurants, ride their roller coasters, go to their hockey games. With my life, any planet I went to, there'd be a bunch of trauma making these fans. Change of 1867. Still 1967. It just works. No, but seriously, on a serious note, I would have a very, very good time checking them out. And I would disguise myself. So why wouldn't it be done here? That's the big question. Why wouldn't it be done here? And I think it is being done here. I really do. I think it is being done here. I mean, there was that story from like 30 years ago where apparently this one alien species fell in love with Las Vegas and they would disguise themselves as humans and land their aircraft or their spacecraft at Area 51 and then take a bus. Yes, you're hearing me correctly. Take a bus from Area 51 into Las Vegas where they would go hang out at the Sahara Hotel. Hold on, I'm going to look this up. This is a great one. I don't remember this one. Story, I forget who wrote it. It's an older story. I used to be really, really cool. I don't know, was it the secondary thing I said? Trust me, I'm just kidding. You probably hear my keyboard. This story was from the moon. I don't know. But this is a good one. Oh, well, I didn't find it right there. But apparently, there was a story that that was happening. Thank you, Howard, for the super chat. Really did appreciate it. But yes, I do believe there are aliens that describe these stories. Why not? Raul, what would you want to see on the alien's planet? Everything. I want to see the creatures. What do they look like? Are they out of, like, Monsters, Inc.? Or are they out of Guardians of the Galaxy? Or Star Wars? Star Trek? I mean, it would be cool. It would be cool to see what they're all about. How they live. I'd probably get to test them. Finding out how long they live, because they were really stuck to find out that they live like 25,000 years. Keith Richards would still be alive, by the way. And in the meantime, here we are, we're lucky if we get 75 to 80. A little bit of a rip-off, if you ask me. I'd like to see what their trees look like. The waterways, if they have any. Do they live above ground or below ground? What do they do for fun? What do they do for fun? How do they procreate? Oh, we're going to have alien hub now. It's going to be interesting. It would be very interesting to have that trip. What do the structures look like? How big are they? Do they build buildings? Do they have subdivisions? Do they have pets? Do they go for a steamed milk And they have a different language when they talk at coffee shops. Like when you go into Starbucks, this is why I never go into a coffee shop. Because I can't understand coffee language. I don't know what a grande is. I don't know what a I don't know. If I order a coffee, which I don't drink. See, Tim Hortons makes it easy. Double double. Purple chicken. Container. None of these fancy names. You know? None of them. You know, if I take a look at the Starbucks menu here. You know? So let's go to some of these drink names here. I don't know what an Irish cream Americano is, or American Misto, or an espresso Campana, or what a flat white is, or a caramel brulee latte, coconut tostada latte with Starbucks blonde espresso. I don't know what that is. I don't. It scares me, to be honest. It's a whole different language in there. I don't even know where to start. It's intimidating for me. Last time I was in a Starbucks, I had to ask the person behind the counter. It was a young lad, and I said, "Sir, can you speak English and not coffee? Because I don't understand coffee language." And he's like, "What do you mean?" I said, "I would like a large hot chocolate, please, with whipped cream." And he goes off on this fancy name. I'm like, "What are you talking about? I don't get it." The last time I was in Starbucks. Starbucks is probably from England. Yes, England. Starbucks is probably England. I really don't know. Moving on, next question here. Let's see here. Let's get time for one more. And then we can. Do you think you can state for charity to be on the civil and have been here on the planet since before human existence? Yes, I do. Yes, I do believe that. You know, look. If these beings have the ability to travel throughout space, they're definitely older than the planet. Definitely older. So it would make sense to me that they were flying here when things were going on. It would. It would totally make sense to me. Totally make sense. So I don't know. I mean, do we know exactly when humankind really started on this planet? We can guesstimate, but I don't really know. They were here before humans, or they were here before the Cro Magnons. You know? I don't know. We have another 30 minutes space out radio. You can get a hold of Butch Witkowski for your chat and your questions again for the final half hour before the bottom of hour number 3, going into the SOR newswire and the final of the stay tuned. Space out radio continues right after this. Hey, everybody, I'm just going to take a quick bathroom break here. I'll be right back. I'm trying to get a hold of Butch once again, so I'll be right back.
This is a new station from the station, shipping the facilities, and otherwise known as Tucson. We're glad to team up with Space and Render to help investigate the experience in the SOM sighting and flight. Together, we'll investigate the space sighting and the things in behind it. We're looking for answers just like you. So please get a sound of your report on the Space and Render website to let's figure out what's going on today.
Our sales department is waiting to hear from you so we can work the reasons to the from commercial sponsors to the owners to the special
is a really difficult thing to imagine because an SOI space travel. Space travel is called as a place where you can connect with other listeners who are all doing so much fun and great fun. This is so stupid. It's crazy. This is John Rising, the Tucson Trust here. If you know anything about our website, you know what we mean why we do things a little differently. We're not some faceless organization collecting money from Japanese parties. Our job is on the same record for collecting free monies. This means we give those shoppers directly to an underdog community of most. To become a donor to Space Out Radio, visit charity.com/donate. Just go to charity.com/donate. Is always on the most than Cleveland. The most than Cleveland is where you want to be when visiting Canada's West Coast. Open until 2 a.m. night, the most cranks up the rock while serving some of the best rated food in the city. The menu starts at $6.95. Why party anywhere else in Van Cleveland when the most is right there? Get your horns up and rock with the most. The official party bomb, Space Out Radio. You have about 90 seconds, everyone. 90 seconds. Seconds. We've reached the third. We're heading for home tonight on Space Dad Radio. My name is Dave Scott. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us. We really do appreciate bringing your listening ears. Hello to everyone listening in on our terrestrial affiliates around North America. Usually on Top Stream Live, KTNL, and Residence Radio. If you want to take a listen to our podcasts, they are free for you by going to youtube.com/spacedoutradio. Just do old baby the favor, hit that subscribe button. It is a time to set the password for tonight in the SOR Space Travelers Club. Practical missile. Practical missile is your password. Use it wisely, Space Travelers. As the plan sets the password each and every night right here on Space Dot Radio. Our website is spacedoutradio.com, where we have a plethora of features for you, including Rocket Bumblefoot and reading up on tech and search SOR Newswire. Follow us on Twitter at spacedoutradio and on Instagram at spacedoutradioshow. Now, we're supposed to have Butch Witkowski on the show tonight for strange things. The problem was, we seem to have a little bit of a technical issue, as Butch literally disappeared. Phone line went dead. You don't know if it's aliens, or if you want to look logically at it, if it was a power outage, a phone line outage, we really don't know. But we are going to keep going here with some audience questions. If you have any questions, head over to Twitter at #space.radio, or you can head over to one of our chat rooms, meaning the YouTube chat room, and connect with us there. We would appreciate it. As we continue on here, one of the things that I want to talk about, we didn't really get into this a week ago, but I want to talk about stupid conspiracy theories. There's a lot of stupid conspiracy theories out there. There really is. Right? And we try really, really hard to stay away from a lot of the idiotic, QAnon-type conspiracy theories that are out there. But this one is just ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. There's a lady out there who is known on YouTube and in the UFO world for being a little bit of a major conspiracy theorist. Well, about a week ago, she decided to make a post and a YouTube video on it about 250,000 Chinese troops lined up on the Canadian border and on the Mexican side of the border to prepare for an invasion of the United States. You know, we already work in a field that does not get a lot of credibility and a lot of mainstream coverage because, let's face it, people already think we are weirdos. Okay? From believing in aliens, Bigfoot, ghosts, spaceships, and all of these broad claims that we make. Right? However, the conspiracy theory that this person created, I think, is absolutely horrible. There is no base for it. There's no information. She tried to put it on as unconfirmed. Think about it, people. It doesn't take a lot of brain power to realize that 250,000 troops of any army would be noticed in North America. Right? It would be noticed in North America. Think about it. There's North. There is NATO. And I'm pretty sure that if they are sailing 250,000 troops to North America, that someone in between, likely the U.S. Navy, is going to pick up the fact that these troops are coming in. All right? Seriously. This is the ridiculousness that kills our industry. It does. Now, the name of the person I'm not going to mention because I don't want to flood this person's YouTube channel with garbage like this. Doesn't deserve the hits. But doesn't deserve the hits. But when you put in a quarter million troops and you're making claims that there's a quarter million troops tucked in on the other side of the border, we're going to notice. The Canadian government is going to notice. The Mexican government is going to notice. And this is where we get into a lot of trouble with this field. And it doesn't make sense as to why to do that. No, I am not assuming. This is truth. This is truth. We have to be careful in this field. In order to do that. Now, there was a rumor that the Canadian military was training them. They were not training soldiers. They had four or five, six generals over here. And the Canadian military threw up a stink about that. As well as the United States government. The conspiracy theories can be very dangerous to our field. And that's why I don't promote them. We have to be able to, we'll never clean up this field as long as there's crap like that in it. We'll never clean up this field. And the unfortunate part about it is there's people, a lot of people out there who believe it. Think about it. How are they flying in or sailing in without radar detection? Somebody's going to look. Japan? We know only the Americans don't like invasions. I'm pretty sure even as small as the Canadian Navy is, we would notice. I'm pretty sure all of the satellites in space would notice any traffic coming our way. Right? So just be careful out there with what you're hearing. Because there's a lot of garbage out there, and unfortunately, it kills what we do. It kills what we do. Moving on. Cody Fletch is asking, what is your all-time favorite cryptid story or creature? I would say my favorite cryptid is still Bigfoot. Sasquatch. My favorite story that I have about him is probably the story of Albert Einstein. This is going back to the 1920s on the west coast of central British Columbia, where he alleges that he was going on a prospecting tour, looking for gold, and on his first night, he was picked up in his sleeping bag and carried off by a Sasquatch. And he was going to be there for 7 days. He was dropped off. He knew what day that he was going to be picked up in the funding by a boat to take him back to the mainland. And on night one, he gets captured by the Sasquatch, who takes him up to his little hut village. There's a wife Sasquatch, a mama Sasquatch. There's two little children Sasquatch running around. And he had his gun with him. He had his cat with him, which is kind of like a mint, like a guilty type mint. He had chewing tobacco. And he stayed with them for like 6 days. And on the seventh day, he knew he had to get back to the water in order to get back. Okay. And then what happened was, on the seventh day, knowing that he had a watch on and he had to be back by a certain time, he apparently gave a bunch of chewing snuff to the male Sasquatch, who got really, really sick. Really sick. Started buffing all over the place. And that's when Albert saw his time to escape. And he started running, and the Papa Bigfoot got a little bit aggressive started chasing him, and that's when apparently he put a shot into the Sasquatch's shoulders, and the Sasquatch continued to chase him down to the bottom. And he hopped on the boat, and both him and the guy who was running the boat saw the Sasquatch. And I went, no! At the edge of the water, that's my favorite Sasquatch story. Totally my favorite Sasquatch story. Abduction, 1920s. Then, if you had to convince someone that Bigfoot is real, what would you tell them? Well, I think you have to start off with the Patterson-Gimlin film. I really do. And then you show them pictures of the footprints. And you take them out into areas if you have that ability. Right? And footprints, you show them. That's what I did with my buddy Mike. Mike had been hunting for 30-plus years. He didn't believe in Sasquatch, never saw anything, never really looked. And I gotta tell you, when I showed him a footprint, he was quite impressed that he had never seen that before. Now, my buddy Mike, he's been a hunting guy. He was an animal catcher on Vancouver Island. He knows this stuff about the outdoors. This guy is a survivalist. And when he saw that footprint, he was like, you've got to be kidding me. You've got to be kidding me. So, I think that if you could bring a person out into the forest and show them the proper signs, and not some bark chewed off a tree, which could be from a moose rubbing its antlers on the tree, or a porcupine, or something along those lines, and a bear. You know, show them definitive proof. That's how I think you can convince people. We're not going to find it on YouTube videos. We're not going to find it on Facebook or Twitter or anything like that. Too many videos have been hoaxed. Too many videos have been played with and doctored. And we look, we're 54 years after the Patterson-Gimlin film. Near 54 years, probably 52. And we're still debating that. And to me, that is 100% real. 100% real. That's probably my favorite Bigfoot story, and the reason why I feel that Bigfoot would be able to be introduced to people. First thing you gotta do is start with Patterson-Gimlin. And when they say, well, I could be a person in a monkey suit, really, is somebody gonna sew a pair of Sasquatch breasts on a monkey suit? I don't think so. I really don't think so. That's just my belief. I'm looking for more questions here from my audience. Go to our chat room on YouTube or on Twitter and hashtag Space Out Radio. You want to check out there. Jim is asking, Dave, have you ever dreamt of aliens? Oh, yeah, many a times. Many a times. Sometimes it's cool. Sometimes it's not so cool. There's a lot of people who believe that if you dream about aliens, you're actually having an extraterrestrial experience. Are we? I really do not know. However, there are those who claim that the aliens can actually put themselves in your mind and make yourself experience something. date would that be?
Can they do that?
We don't know. There are many who believe that we can. There are many who believe that if you dream about aliens, they are actually there taking you. That's what I find hard about experiences. Like, I have had those dreams. I've woken up with marks on my body. Do I believe that I've had those experiences? Absolutely. Absolutely. However, the truth is, we don't know. I hate to say that because it's so unworthy. So unworthy. But you get people who have had face-to-face encounters while they're awake, like we did with Carla at the Windhead back in 2015, that's where stuff gets real. That's where stuff gets really real. And that's the experience I wish everybody could have. Eugene says, they were more than dreams, my good Dave. Yes, they were, Eugene. Yes, they were. I would agree with you then. So, I'm a firm believer in that. At points, yes. I do believe it is aliens. I do believe that we all have active imaginations. For instance, if you watch a certain type of film, you're going to dream nightmares. Alright? I remember a few weeks ago, I was watching the series called The Purge. And I was having nightmares. I had a nightmare one night about being chased by people who wanted to kill me. Because it was Purge night. Got away, got into a solidified building, and it was scary. That's kind of what we do. Adrian Harris is asking, do you believe that shooting stars and UFOs are being shot down by other aliens in some galactic war? No, I do not. No, I do not. I think there's too much proof out there to say that it's sunset. I shouldn't say all the time, but I would say the majority of time is space junk coming down, meteors coming down, pieces of asteroid coming down. And I'm sure it may happen. Why wouldn't it? Or why couldn't it? It's very interesting. Howard, it's been a while, but have you seen the shadow dog recently? The last experience we had with the shadow dog at the house was scratching at the door. So, I brought the dogs in. Closed the door behind me, and then there was like a bump and a scratch at the door, like my dogs would normally do when they want to come inside. So, for those who don't know the story, I have had a shadow dog around my house. It's kind of cool because this shadow dog actually looks like my bright German Shepherd. Whose name, coincidentally, is Shadow. I call him Mr. Dog. So, I've seen this Shadow Dog 3 times here. And then there was this thing about a week ago. I don't know if it's a dark image. Like when I say dark, I mean evil. I don't think so. It doesn't feel that way. I just don't know. But it is kind of interesting that it continues. And it seems to be going on a weekly basis sort of thing. I just got a message from Butch. And this is what it says in text for me. You know, sorry big guy, lost all power at the subdivision. Transformer took out everything. We'll have to do a recap for SOR. So Butch apologizes that he lost all power at his house, which we kind of figured would happen. But at least he was nice enough to let us know. At least he, I guess we now have confirmation that it wasn't aliens that moved him. kind of sucks, because that would have been real cool if that's what actually happened. But it didn't go that way. So thankfully, Butch is still around. He's alive. His phone isn't. His power isn't. What a time to lose power when it's cool, though. See, I don't mind losing power where I can. If I lost power here, the cool part about it is, I don't find a place to keep the house for. I'm in a big wood stove. Light that sucker up, we'll be just fine. But for a lot of people out there, who don't need that secondary heating system, that's what gets them thinking. But I always ask them, are they alien ghosts? I think there are aliens who can disguise themselves as ghosts. I have a photograph of an alien from a ghost tour, standing in a gallery from the museum. That was taken by Merle's buddy Jeff. That's kind of cool. That's one of the reasons why I think that all can be connected. PH is asking, any news on the Two of the Stars Academy? The latest news on them is they will be shutting down their storefront in San Diego on January 31st. There has been no replacements for Luis Elizondo, Chris Mellon, or Steve Justice in leading. But in typical Thunderdome fashion, we are told, stay tuned. Just be patient. Things are happening. Everything will still be awesome. As long as he has Jason Leon and Hal Pudoff involved, I think that they'll be able to bring more people on the table. And the other thing that we don't know about the PT incident is who is working behind the scenes, and will they take the time to step forward and put their name on the board of directors or ask people involved? That'd be very, very interesting indeed. So we sneak in one more here. Atlanta, so you're saying that Thomas and Dylan is a real Sasquatch movie? Yes, I do believe that that is a real Sasquatch movie. Thank you to everybody for participating in tonight's show and being patient with Butch Witkowski. When we come back from the break, we are going to go to the SOI Newsline, where Jackie Schultz is fully loaded for the news. And it looks pretty good tonight. It really does. And we're going to get to the thought of the days as well. Once again, before Butch's website there, it is Butch Witkowski's website is ufocop.com. That's ufocop.com. So make sure you check it out if you have a site. We'll be back to the final half of the season. I would explain the saddle bag in my hand. I would have confused them. Oh, that hit. No, I don't think there is any connection between the two. I hope she got it, by the way. Minister, I did ask one of your questions. Please forgive me, guys. Okay, having to do this all of a sudden tonight, and with the way the chat room is moving, I couldn't normally keep updated, so when all of a sudden a question popped up, that's the one I got. So it isn't personal or anything like that. brains that have missing questions on the radio. I know there's a lot of questions, man. I'm sorry, I do apologize. Nice fun, everybody. Nice fun. I like that one. I wonder if that is this one thing my buddies and not me. It'd be interesting. Tomorrow night we have a journalist called named Chrissy Elliott. She will be talking about Bigfoot, aliens, and sex cults. On Wednesday night, we have Linda Thompson. She used to work for, what's the other agency that she worked for? A private company that has government contracts. I forget, but we're going to talk to UFOs and kind of like private companies doing work for them. To work on UFOs that's crash landed. She's got an amazing interview experience too. Thursday night we have Ryan Stacy from Tesla, and then Friday night we have the SOR roundtable, which we're just putting together as well. Thank you, Clarence, for posting that, by the way, on Twitter. Appreciate that. Thank you so much for that awesome super chat, dude. Really appreciate that. Really appreciate that. Thank you for your continued support, man. That'd be really cool, man. Really cool. Sandra, you asked something earlier that I meant to get. No, we're not booking him for the show. We are not booking him for the show. Are you doing anything better? What do you expect us? Searching the chat room for a date. We have 25 seconds. Well, I haven't seen Lisa Rosenberg in a long time. Where is she hiding, Eugene? Where is she hiding? We're bringing it forward. We're heading for home today on Space Out Radio. I'm your host, Dave Smith. Thank you so much for taking the time to join us. We really do appreciate you. Each and every one of you tuning in. So we want to remind you that if you miss most of this show or others, you can check out our free archives by going to youtube.com/spaceoutradio. Just do me the favor, hit that subscribe button. Our website is spaceoutradio.com, where we have a plethora of features for you, including rocking out the Bundlefoot and reading up on tech and shirts and so on news one. Follow us on Twitter at spaceoutradio and on Instagram at spaceoutradio show. Speaking of the news, let's do this thing, shall we? The news is always confusing, which is why we bring you the SOR news one, the best thing to ever show. But we get to the weird, the strange, the wacky, and sometimes the underpants. Yes, apparently there are now bands of underpants with a penis spot. A forbidden angel sweaty testes and even boost fertility. Now, if somebody called Just Wears offers a snug little spot for your member to sit away from your, you know what, meaning no more hot boxing while you're in the bun. Well, for the phallus by its creators, the underpants are made from a ventilated fabric on the underside, which allows more air to circulate the wearer's undercarriage. According to this company, the material used to make them, sustainable Austrian deep springs, is 50% more absorbent and breathable than cotton, and combined to keep your jewels dry. Apparently, they say, we invented a unique ergonomic pouch to treat your crown jewels like royalty. The upper pouch function is quick draw access. Well, that's good, because Lord knows we don't want any mistakes when we go to the bathroom. You know, the brand was the brainchild of Alex and Eugene, who met in a youth hospital in Thailand. Luckily, they were tired of games with us in that area, decided to make some breathables. Took about 30 hours, they reached their target, and they were selling them, and doing very well. They've already sold 65,000 pairs to 25,000 customers around the world. I'm telling you, I have a different pair. I'm wearing them right now. Not this time, a different one, and they feel good. They feel really good. We're finally getting some improvement down there, boys. Finally getting some improvement. In honor of Robin Burns Day, there's a packet of Haggis that has been launched into the edge of space for the first time. Star Sports and Simon Howie worked with space education and research firm Stratonauts to launch a 454-gram Haggis into Perth and Timorth this month. The Haggis was attached to a weather balloon and soared for more than 20 miles or 107,298 feet above Earth, equivalent of nearly four times the height of Everest. After taking off from the Simon Howie headquarters in Denny, it traveled over Sterling, Falkirk, Edinburgh, and Pentland Hills before landing safely in water in the Borders. Mr. Howie said he wanted to start the year by lifting the spirits of the general public and was thrilled to work with Stratonauts to take Scotland's national dish. This to be his hands. Burns Night is one of the most popular dates of the food calendar for us, and we wanted to mark the occasion by sending the UK's best-selling Haggis into the edge of space, he said. McCallie and Mr. Howie said that the company has worked hard to increase production in the run-up to Christmas and now Burns Night, which Scots celebrate on the 25th of January to mark the life and the works of poet Robbie Burns. Haggis. That stuff's gross, by the way. It really is. Okay. This report here is another reason why it is dumb to go in the ocean. If 2021 is going to be anything like 2012, let's face it, you're probably going to get killed by sharks. That's the way it comes. In what's called an unusually deadly year, sharks killed 10 people around the world in unprovoked attacks in 2020. The highest number since 2013, according to a report released by the International Shark Attack File. Six of the deaths were in Australia waters, and three were in the United States, one each in California, Hawaii, and Maine, which is a first for that state. The other death was in St. Martin's, a Caribbean island. 10 is a high number. Two deaths were reported in 2019, four in 2018. The annual global average is 5 or 6. All the deaths were up last year. The number of non-fatal attacks was low in 2020 at just 57. That's well below the average of 80. Still too many. Though the incidence of bites, both in the USA and globally, declined, 2020's number represented a more drastic drop than would be expected based on the analysis of long-term trends, the International Shark Attack File said in a statement. As we first reported in June, the observed drop in shark bite incidents may have been caused by widespread quarantines, closed beaches, and minimized vacation travel in response to COVID-19. Researchers at the file based at the Florida Museum of Natural History tracked attacks in the shark's natural habitat in which there was no human provocation. Consistent with long-term trends, the USA experienced the most unprovoked attacks in 2020 with 33 confirmed cases. So in other words, 33 times sharks tried to make humans food. Overall, the global battle between humans and sharks is probably a fair fight. Humans kill about 100 million sharks and rays each year. That sucks. Most are killed by commercial fishermen for fins and flesh. That's disgusting. Leave the sharks alone. They're doing a good job patrolling the ocean, and they do not want humans here. By the way, the chances of being killed by a shark are relatively low, 3,748,067 to 1. Still too low for me. If that was about 100 million to 1, I might consider dipping a pinky toe in the ocean. But until that odds change, there's no way. Leave the sharks alone. Don't kill them. They're beautiful animals. They deserve to swim in their natural habitat. We just don't need to be the food that they are feeding on. It's just that simple. Just that simple. A former Transportation Security Administration agent who was accused of tricking a traveler into showing her boobies as she went through the security at LA International Airport has pleaded no contest to false imprisonment, authorities said. Jonathan Lenny entered the plea Friday for a felony count and was sentenced to 60 days in county jail, 52 classes of dress and sexual compulsion, and 2 years probation. Lenny was also barred from working as a security guard. He was charged with using fraud or deceit to falsely imprison the woman in June of 2019. The woman told investigators that Lenny told her that he had to look inside her bra to ensure she wasn't hiding anything, had her remove her pants away from her waist for a check, and then said he would take her to a private room for further security screening. Prosecutor said, but when they were alone on an elevator, Lomelli told the woman he could perform the screening there and ordered her to lift her shirt and show her breast. Then looked down her pants. What a pervert. Lomelli then told the woman she was free to go and added that she had nice breasts, authorities said. After the woman was arrested, California Attorney General Xavier Becerra said that there was that the former TSA's agent actions representing the mistreatment of women that should not be tolerated. Women deserve to be treated with dignity and respect everywhere, he said. There is no excuse for this kind of alleged behavior. It's not okay on the street, it's not okay in schools, and it's certainly not welcome at the airport. Good for him for getting fired. Good for him. All right, moving on. Women look a little bit different than when the pandemic began. Loungewear for skirts, slippers for heels, bare faces for painted ones. Some of us are hairier too. Andrea DeWeird, a Brooklyn, works in a book publishing company. She says, I never wear makeup or blow drying my hair for work again. Julia Liss, who's just 27, a technology sales executive in New York, vows she's done wearing heels. 41-year-old Marie Diamond from Jacksonville said, I went from shaving my legs every few days to not shaving at all since April. So, this is what was done by the USA Today, by the way. We have heard from dozens of women who say that despite the pandemic's lockdown, social restrictions, and mask mandates, they relaxed beauty standards and have accompanied their retreat from public life, and it's been liberating. If there's one thing good that's come from the COVID mess, it's that I was able to find myself, Cameron said. The hell with it all. Who are we really doing this all for? Not myself, because I hate that routine. If the pandemic had offered women any reprieve, it may have been from societal expectations around appearance. More at home bound, interacting less, zooming more, and beauty routines and fashion choices have adapted in time. When the pandemic sharpened the divide between our public lives and our private selves, it gave women space to examine what they want to do to their bodies and why. The question is, will any of these relaxed beauty norms stick once the pandemic is over? Look, I think women look beautiful with great makeup. Most of them, 90% of the time, I prefer it. I do. But shaving the legs and the armpits? I don't know. I guess I should shave my face, though. That would make it easier, right? Because Lord knows I haven't shaved much since the pandemic. Look at my beard! So I don't blame women for that, to be honest. They say, Texas for months and closed roads leading to the pond in southern Texas. However, they ended up not evacuating local residents, indicating that there would be no launch attempt on January 25th. It is possible that winds at the high watershed were just too high, and the gusts were said to be nearly 30 miles per hour at the surface. This means the company is likely to try again when the roads are scheduled to be closed, and the winds are forecast to be a little bit more favorable after a series of static fire tests on its latest Starship prototype. SpaceX appears to set to launch the full-scale vehicle from its rocket facility. The nominal plan is for the prototype to ascend to an altitude as high as 12.5 kilometers, perform a belly flop maneuver, seemingly bleeding off energy during the return to Earth's atmosphere, reorient itself, and then land a launch pad. Only a little more than 6 weeks ago, since SpaceX conducted a similar test of its SN8 vehicle in South Texas, that one, ended up crashing on the landing. Well, if you didn't have the landing, we had to take the vaccines away from them. Otherwise, it would look really good. Moving on, scientists have found a 34-year-old grizzly bear in southwest Wyoming, identifying him by a mark on his lip made by biologists in 1989. As the oldest grizzly ever known in the Yellowstone region, that includes parts of Montana, Idaho, and Wyoming. They say, respect your biologists. There's no telling if there are any older grizzlies currently roaming Yellowstone, since hundreds of the creatures are completely unmarked by scientists, but this one by far is the oldest one with whom there is scientific documentation. That's quite cool. Sadly, the biologist had to put the bear down. He was captured last summer after he got caught preying on calves in the nearby ranch. After euthanizing the creature last July, biologists found an identifying tattoo on his lip that read 168, a mark given to the creature in 1989. The bear was a male, which is notable as female grizzlies generally live longer than males. Previously, the oldest known grizzly in Yellowstone was born at 399, a female who died at age 27. When caught, 168 had just 3 teeth left, and they were ground down to the nuts, a sure sign of old age and an explanation for why the animal was going after easy prey like calves. He was also quite emaciated, weighing just 170 pounds, which is nothing for a grizzly, but he was captured in the Tucson National Forest in August 1991. Records show he weighed 450 pounds. Yellowstone biologists consider the grizzly's bodily health based on a 1 to 5 scale, with a 1 being the worst shape and a 5 being the worst. That doesn't make sense. With 1 being in the worst shape and 5 being the worst. When he was captured, 168 was ranked as 0. Because of his failing physical condition, Tucson Wildlife Service biologist made the call to euthanize the animal last July instead of relocating him to a more remote part of Yellowstone. It was sad that we had to put him down, but ethically, there was nothing else that could be done, Dan Thompson, a biologist with Wyoming Game and Fish, had mentioned. Researchers knew quite a bit about the bear from past records. Grizzly 168 was first captured when he was 3 years old. That's when scientists gave him his identifying tattoo, then recaptured in Fremont County, Wyoming, in 1996. Over the next few years, he lost his radio collar, so scientists aren't totally sure what he was up to, but DNA tests show that he likely fathered 3 kids in the mid-2000s and may have had more kids later in later years when he was 23 and again when he was 31. Speaking of bears, a man riding a tour list at a Romanian ski resort caught a scary video. A tense moment when a fellow skier was being chased by a bear. David Trio posted a video on YouTube showing the bear chasing the skier on a slope at the Pradia ski resort this past Saturday. Fearless riders alerted the skier to the pursuit, and the skier threw his backpack on the ground, which succeeded in distracting the bear for long enough to allow the man to escape. Police spokesman Ian Zaharia said the skier did the right thing by distracting the bear. He said 3 emergency calls came in about the bear being spotted in various locations. Zaharia said the bear fled into the woods when police arrived in all terrain vehicles, but authorities are considering having the bear relocated to avoid future confrontations on the slopes. I hope they would. Finally tonight, the coronavirus pandemic has produced a ripe environment for text message phishing attacks. Such scams are socially engineered to exploit people's vulnerable impulses, experts say, and have sharply risen in 2020. Many Americans sign up for text message notifications and reminders from healthcare providers to shipping services. But as SMS phishing becomes more widespread, consumers will have to exercise more vigilance with texts of unknown origins. Because you don't want to be ripped off, people. Let's just face it. If you get a text from a number you don't recognize, it's probably garbage. And this is why you're confirming your spaced out radio interview. Father, the day has happened to remember this time where we answer the question on our Facebook and Twitter pages, then read your responses on the email because we love the audience participation around here. Today's Father, the day is as follows. What would you do if you found a set of fresh cryptid footprints? Next, take many pictures, especially of where the prints came from and where they go. Hopefully, don't get eaten by bad men. Sure, I don't want to be photographed, but it would be great to test it. I now plan to take on every height a testing kit. Morris, environmental DNA is the only thing we should be thinking about. We've taken pics and tests for years. We don't need any more. DNA is the next step. Lori, right now is slow. Take a few pictures of them. Follow them to the ears and eyes on a swivel. And then be happy. All I've heard over the years are one brief glimpse of Bigfoot. To me, it's proof enough that I'm not crazy. Also, hope the footprints I found are not of God man. We're taking pictures. Get out of Dodge safely as possible. Corinth. A different Corinth. This one likes Hallmark movies. Take pictures and video and emphasize and show in the video where the footprints were at in reference to the remoteness of where they were at. Joe, I got my phase plasma rifle in the 40-watt range and let loose the hounds. David, call them the backwards. Jim had their feet on backwards, and Himalayan scientists believe that Yetis do too. This means investigate. Harry, take pics, take a sample to see if there's any DNA, and test it. Dave Roberts, photos, videos, and testing. Chris, I took my dogs out and try to follow them, then take plastic models and photos, and call you, Dave. Well, send me a test, because I would love a Sasquatch footprint test for the studio. Holly, to keep the pictures, mark the area and see if there's any DNA or berries left behind. I'd love to go and go back later with some gravy and try and make a plastic cast if I can manage to get back in the area. Alex, we should always collect dirt and debris on the print itself because once you mess with the print, touch it or test it, you contaminate it and can't get the DNA out of the print. Cable Guy Matt says, I'm going to follow the tracks. Well, of course you are, Cable Guy Matt, because I'm going to be right beside you. Honest Michelle, I would take pictures and test the prints. I would also start looking for hair or scat in the area. Then I would go find the cryptid. I would then lure him home with Humpty Dumpty cheese sticks. When I got him home, I would just say, hey, here's another cat. Marty, one of our favorite veterans, great client tonight, Marty. Because after taking the cast and pictures, I would take my findings to a reputable shoe shop and make them what I mean is the Bigfoot sneakers to sell on the internet and make a ton of money. That would be awesome. Anthony, immediately pull my camera from my bag and start shooting photos. Mickle, I'd say thank you and ask them not to hurt me. And to wish them well and to not be a friend of mine. Go ahead and take a picture and plaster it on social media for everyone to see. Another hours. Keep in mind that collecting DNA is the only thing we should be doing. Pics and casts are in the past. We don't need any more of the past. We need some DNA future. Keep in mind that if you don't collect dirt, debris, or the print or track, you are contaminating the site and cannot get accurate DNA out of it. John, I'm going to wake up from passing out from overexcitement and hyperventilating with tears of joy. I'm going to call you guys. I'm there. I will show them. Joseph, try to eliminate what it could not be before jumping to the conclusion that it is a cryptid and then try to guess what kind of cryptid it could be, then take some photos and try and tell others about it. Shannon, well, she sends me a gift of a giant goat with a monkey riding on his back. Marty, talked about with photos and was cast as feasible, he would turn around and go home like it was none of my business, play some vinyl, and pour myself a drink. $13 just the last word for the month. Technically, other king, ice king, dragon king, had non-human souls, hence, cryptids walking about and making arrangements with them. Thank you to everybody participating in the Thought of the Day, as we will do it all again tomorrow on Facebook and Twitter. Thank you, Captain Kirk, for the SOR Newsletter, and to Butch Witkowski and all of your audience participation tonight. We got Mr. Ron Bubblefoot Thaw rocking in the background with a little brother who's watching. Bumblefoot is the official music of Spacecraft Radio, rocking in some manner of every single show. Ear horns up with a guitar, God and stuff. Special thanks to everybody listening in at home, at work, in your cars, wherever you may be. Thank you to everyone tuning in the chat rooms tonight on YouTube, LDAB, Revolution Radio. We have the Space Foundation for Facebook. And all the stalkers and strikeouts tweeting away at hashtag Space Foundation. Remember, this show is copyrighted by Space Foundation Radio and SMR Media Ventures Limited. Thank you so much for choosing to share your evening with us. Because together, my friends, we sit with me. We are the night, Mr. Bubblefoot. We need a space. We need a space customer. Yes, the routine has done it for the night. But tomorrow, my friends, we shall ride again. Your seats are always available. Your tickets never expire. And if you want to bring a friend, yep, you got them for them too. That was fun, everyone. Oh, man. Pray by Butch. Pray, you made a very nice looking job, just so you know. You did. Very nice looking job. It's only in New York, that's the temperature in New York. Let me find out. Right now, it is the whopping minus 7 Celsius, 20 degrees Fahrenheit outside the city. It's not too bad. Well, hopefully tomorrow the audio is a little bit better for you guys. Like I said, on my end, I'm just going to test the speaker audio here, but on my end, when we were doing it, when I did my phone checks and when Chuck audio got accepted from where he was on both YouTube and Springfield. It was sounding fine for him. So I'm not quite sure why, for half of you, the audio was rough, but for the other half, it was perfect. I'm not understanding about that. And it sucks from the bathroom, too, because I believe he was reading a bunch of your comments. Our changing of the levels should not have hurt the stream. That's what we need to figure out. I'm going to talk about that tomorrow. And then 64 degrees in northeast Bahamas. That's T-shirt and shorts weather, my friend. T-shirt and shorts weather. What is that?
UFO sightings, because we've had some really cold weather.
A mild winter here, so
they do not see them. The night towards the warm up.
To bring their investment a little convoluted, because we're going to try. It's a little different than you, but we're going to see that. It sounds perfect. Perfect. Okay. Bill, is it your birthday? Please confirm whether it's your birthday or not. We appreciate that. Bill doesn't do this.
Thank you.
This is so beautiful.
There were two shows. One was on a Sunday night, the other was on like a Wednesday. And they were both from UFOs, the place where I was doing stuff like that. And I'm like, screw one of those guys. He's never left the street. But he was a recently. And that's where it really gets me right now. They start playing this, look, there are no experts in ufology. There are no experts in cryptozoology. And there are no experts in the paranormal. What we find, we find. What we miss, we miss.
Butch Witkowski is joining us tonight on Space Out Radio. I'm going to ask you, Butch, in regards to these things, Chuck's I did the same thing. This is so weird. So weird. Could be Crow Creek. Could be Developing Crow Creek. Thank you for joining us, man. with the bomb, that's why I'm redoing the bomb just to see what's going on. Thank you for listening to the video. On this note, I'm going to say goodbye to everyone here. Thank you to Vinster. Thank you to Harry. Thank you to Trappers. Thank you to Gorgeous Kira. Big Dog, TH, and Ken Chiefer for the amazing super chats tonight. I'm going to try and get this all fixed up for tomorrow. And so that way, hopefully, we are running properly. But I'm going to talk to you guys tomorrow. I'm going to fix this frustration. So, we'll talk to you tomorrow, guys. Take care.